Welcome, good evening everybody. Shalom aleichem, excited you guys could make it. Very exciting tonight, Baruch Hashem. It's a special program, this is a unique program. It's actually the brainchild of our first teacher, Rabbi Kyle John Engelson, who has to tell you a little bit about himself. He ran a Fortune 500, Inc. 500 company. And he has a tremendous amount of insight into taking a business concept and turning it into a reality. And so this is going to be two parts. There's two halakim, two parts to this. John is going to give a 40-minute presentation from mind to market, right? How you take an idea and you make it happen. And then afterwards, we're going to have the world-famous Yossi Applebaum, who is a also a Think 500 company and a former board member of CHYE and an all-star marketer and guru of business. And he's going to talk about from market to pocket. Now that you made that product, how do you get it out there so that people start buying it and put the money in the pocket? So it's a very exciting program and excited that you're all here tonight. Without further ado, we call up our illustrious instructor. Throughout the class, if anyone needs to, there's a restroom back here behind the curtain. And hope you're comfortable. If they stay uncomfortable, if there are any issues, you can let me know. But by all means, please.
Okay, with the ray, this is like double scoop. Welcome. My name is John Michael Engelson, and really thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us for this really supposed to be a very exciting evening of really just to have some insight on this concept of idea from mind to market. People have ideas, and how to really make those ideas real, how to make them into something that's tangible. So first I want to thank a bunch of people. You have to get those for sure thankfulness. Baruch Hashem, thank God for strength to come and do the evening. And thank very much CHYE and Rabbi Wordy and his whole staff. Give a big hand to start with the amazing work that they do here. It's just really, it's an incredible resource for people who are starting businesses, who have businesses, who are looking to start a business. They have staff here, Yehuda Berg, who's on pretty much full staff here. Who's an expert at a lot of the practicalities of raising funds for a business, bank loans, things like that. So incredible, incredible staff here. I of course want to thank my partner here, Yossi Applebaum, a incredible marketing maven. I'm going to give you a lot of nuts and bolts tonight, but he's going to be like the icing on the cake. The exciting part. Oh no, hopefully it will be exciting. We're going to weave it in with a bunch of stories. But I figure it's very important. You all came here probably with an idea, and it's really important to have those nuts and bolts, because without them, let's face it, that's how a business gets started, and that's how we want to make a business successful. A little background on myself. I have an economics degree from UC San Diego. I graduated in 1983, and I didn't really use a lot of my degree. I ended up in a purchasing agent job, and then I got laid off 6 months after that, and I ended up in a sales telemarketing job, which actually was the best thing that ever happened to me. And I learned the skill of sales from two of the best salespeople I believe I could ever have learned from, and those skills took me into the beginning of my career, and then to found a company in 1991 called You Are What You Eat. my son came home from school with rashes. My wife and I were really upset, and we had been into nutrition and health food, and didn't understand why they couldn't have healthy snacks in the schools. I started to call schools, and I was interested. I said, you know, why don't you guys have healthy snacks? And I started the company on that premise. And that actually took, fast forwarding, but that actually took to the mass market. We really pioneered. If you see a nutrition section in a supermarket or in a drugstore, we were doing that in the 90s. They didn't exist. And we ended up selling pretty much, I was on the West Coast, but pretty much every major chain in Southern California. And then as chains got bought out in the late 90s, we expanded that.
Sold snack bags?
I'm sorry?
You sold like snack bags?
No, like energy bars, like a nutrition. You see a section of like health products in a store where you'd see like Garden of Eden chips, a Clif bar, all the energy bars, all those type of. Yeah, and so that was UR Each Week. We built it up to an Inc. 500 fastest growing company in 1998, number 441. Ran it a couple more years, and sort of challenges came to the market. We kind of divested. Go into it another time. But what I learned from that experience, there's a lot of things I'm going to share with you tonight of how the idea actually came. I had an idea, a thought, how I got it into reality. And I want to share pretty much how the challenges that people have when starting a company, that hopefully we can prevent some of those challenges. There's always going to be challenges, of course, but it's very, very key to understand certain basics that can help one maneuver around unnecessary challenges. It's always going to be, every business is fraught. I don't care what the biggest business, the smallest business, is going to have challenges. But really what I want to do here tonight is to go over the nuts and bolts that will really help with the success, and try to stay away from the weeds. Just to bring enter a little bit, we always try to start with a little bit of a Dvar Torah, but just to bring a little Hasidus into this concept. Chabad is Chokhma, Bina, and Dabar, wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. Chokhma in Hasidut is the idea of a flash of an idea. Bina is the idea to bring it down into more details. And Daat is the idea of to make it real, to make it into reality. This is, in a nutshell, it goes into volumes and volumes. But I'd like to just extrapolate that with the same idea in a business, in an idea. A person has an idea all the time. They have ideas all the time. It's a flash. What is it? I have an idea to do this. I have an idea to do this. I can make this. It's a creativity. Everyone has creativity. It's a flash. And a lot of times it just comes and goes. Get the idea coming. And sometimes the idea sticks with a person. The person starts to think, you know, maybe this, there's something to it. So they go to the next step and they start to maybe write it down, think of the details, how it could be. But the hardest part, without question, is to make it real. It's to make it into reality. So many ideas either stay in the idea of a thought, speech, people talk about it all the time. Talk is, as they say, talk can be cheap. Come up to you, I have this idea, this idea, this. But to really, really make it a reality, that's the nuts and bolts. That's where the pedal meets the metal, as they say. So the genesis of tonight was a two-part seminar, which really was to take this idea of an idea. Some people here are all over the place. They have made, in a good sense, they have many ideas, are very creative. Some people may have already written down these ideas. Some people may have expanded their ideas here. And some people may have even started the ideas. So whatever stage that anybody is in this process, we will, with God's help, help you through that. And 2 hours from now, you will walk out with a practical way of succeeding your idea. Practical, useful tools to make your ideas a reality. And between the foundations that we're going to talk about, which we call the seven aspects of bringing an idea to reality, the seven concepts, and the crown of those concepts, which will be the second part of the evening, which is my partner Yossi, is really the crown is sales and marketing, because that is the engine, that is the gas to any idea. It has to have that. So we're going to go right into it without further ado, to start from mind to market. So you can take notes. I only would ask if kindly turn the cell phone ringers off. That would be great, so everyone can concentrate. Okay, let's start. Number one, have a good idea for a product or service. I mean, let's talk the difference between a business and an idea and a hobby. People came for a hobby tonight. I'm not for that. If you have a lot of money and you want to do this, you want to make a recipe and this and that, that's a hobby. To make something a business, that's what we're going to really, really get into tonight. So have an idea. That's the first thing. What is an idea? It has to be carefully defined that you're going to have a product or service that solves a problem, has a benefit for somebody. What does it do? What does your idea do? What is it going to, why does it need to come to the market? That's the first question. A key question and a key phrase that most entrepreneurs and most business people, even when they're in business, have a very, very, very difficult time explaining is what we call a USP, a unique selling proposition. Why are you necessary? Why is your business necessary? Why is your product necessary? If you ask anybody who's in business, what differentiates your product and service? A lot of people have difficulty answering that question. And because they have difficulty answering that question, their product and service is not going to be exactly what I would say tip-top. In other words, a person has to know why are they in business? What are they providing? That why is somebody using their product or service? It's the ABC of the question. And the ABC every company has to answer. So the first thing that everybody should be thinking about with their product or service is what will make you unique? What will differentiate your product or service? Why is it necessary? Now, don't get scared, please. There are lots and lots of simple, practical businesses that are necessary that seem not to, that didn't reinvent the wheel. You don't have to go out and reinvent the wheel. You can see businesses, you can walk up and down Kingston that are doing very, very well and flourishing, like cleaners, restaurants, and it's, you don't have to come out with an idea that nobody came out with. It's very rare, as a matter of fact. You know, an Apple iPhone doesn't come out every day. The fact is that you take businesses that have very high barrier to entry, and it's very hard to even think of a concept of how you could compete. For instance, you take a company like FedEx and UPS. So let's say you had an idea of being a better carrier of goods and packages. You know how many billions of dollars you need to start this company? And you're going to be better than FedEx. You're going to be better than UPS. That's why there's only two. I mean, you have the mail service, but I mean, that's it. DHL, little foreign stuff. The barrier to entry is so high in that type of business that who would need it? Who would go through it? Who would invest in it? How are you going to do it better? It's very, very, very complex. However, you see businesses with very little barrier entry, like a restaurant. Thousands and thousands of restaurants all over the place. Why? Because it's very, very little barrier to entry, number one. Number two, a lot of the restaurants differentiate themselves with, they have a recipe passed down from generation to generation, I have grandma's pasta sauce, and they can differentiate themselves and be very, very unique in a standing location and become very, very successful. So those are the two ends of the spectrum. And somewhere, any of the ideas that you might have here tonight might be in between. But that's a very, very important point. How hard is it to get your idea into a reality, and what are the barriers to entry? Also, we spoke about this idea that you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You're not going to come out with the new wheel. There was a book years ago by Randy Bartlett called The 1% Solution, and he basically says how small incremental changes in a product and service can lead to tremendous, tremendous rewards. So, meaning that, he gives two examples. He gives an example of a horse race and a golf tournament. In a horse race, the first horse could win by a nose. How much better is he than the second horse? I mean, 1/100th of a second, maybe. But the difference in prize money between the first the winner and second can be double, astronomical. Like a golf tournament. Is the number one golfer, they just had the US Open golf tournament, the number one golfer that much better than number two? It could be this much, an inch. But the prize difference, the glory, so to speak, is so much greater. That concept of being 1% better can be in many, many aspects of your business. But to shoot for that is realistic. To be a little bit better, to be a little bit cleaner, to be a little bit faster, this is real. So I just wanted to bring a few of these ideas to give you some thought about your ideas so that, number one, you can see them a little bit better and see that the obstacles are there, but maybe not that great. That's number one. When the ones have a product, what is unique and special? Number two, is your idea viable and scalable? What does that mean? First of all, can it really happen? Can this idea, is it just something in the air? I mean, is it something that is really can come into practicality? Again, I come back to that whole idea, is it a hobby or is it a real business? I don't know if anybody watches any Shark Tank, but I find it a very interesting show, but a lot of times, some of the answers are, hey, this isn't a business. That's one of their answers to they come up with something, and like, I see it, it's a good idea, but is it a business? What we really want to do here tonight is to make you think of how you can take your idea and to make it actually a business, an entity that is actually running and working and the wheels are flowing. So, is it viable? Is it scalable? What does it mean scalable? That you have an idea. Is it local? Could it go to the city? Could it go national? Or is it just something only on a small scale? And that's not necessarily bad, but you have to be able to identify that originally, because that will help one know what to do and what steps to take. Because if you're opening, let's just say you wanted to, I'll give my example, if I was only going to sell energy bars in an area here on, let's say, you know, Kingston Avenue to Albany, to Brooklyn, how much can I do in business? Not much. It would be very, very, I couldn't survive. So the point is it scalable? Is your product or idea or your service, can it be done only in a certain small area? Can it be done in the city, nationally? Can it be done internationally? Now, this is a very, very key phrase, and I guess there's going to be about five or six of them. So, you know, try to highlight a few key phrases. But you can have a great product and a lousy operation of your business, and it's very likely you're going to fail. The business will fail. And again, when I say your business, it's not you. Everyone has had it. It's not a personal thing. If you can have an average product and a great operation, and you can be wildly successful. What's the proof? Look at the market. Look at the market. So many average products on the shelf. Nothing. They do this. They do that. Nothing major. But the reason is that they're successful because they have successful operations. It means their accounting department, their operation department, their human resource, whatever it is, they have an operation that's streamlined and good. I made numerous mistakes because I was good, and we're going to get to this later, but of what somebody's good at. But I made numerous mistakes because even though you have to run the whole business, I did not know how to delegate. And that cost me a lot because I was doing things for a long period of time that I was not good at. And when you do that, which was operations, which I wasn't good at, because I was trained in sales and marketing, and when the business started to go bigger and bigger, and I really needed that help, I ran into great challenges because I wasn't the guy who was going to make sure the truck was on time, that the goods were delivered on time, that the guy got up at 7 o'clock and got to this account. I was just going, my thing was sales, just sell. But you can't have a sale. Sales like is like light and vessel. Sales like a light, and the product's like the vessel. And if you don't have both, you just have you have an empty shell. You have an empty shell. So that's why I ran into a lot of challenges, which I'm going to get to in a couple of minutes when we get into another topic. So that's number two: is your idea viable and scalable? Number three. By the way, just as a structure of this evening, once I finish the nuts and bolts, and then Yossi gets into the sales and markets, then we're going to have a question and answer. We're open for anything. You know, we'll have like a half an hour of that. So, you know, although if something's necessary to have a question in the meantime, no problem, but there will be open for questions and answers. Okay, number three. The world's best kept secret. Not such a secret, but I like to say it's the world's. It's called private label. Everybody's heard of it, but very few people who start a business or have an idea know that it's there for you to count on. What does it mean? If you have an idea for something, you have an idea for a hardware item, you have an idea for a food item, you have an idea for a housing item, You think you have to make it yourself. It's not true. What is the biggest private label company in the world, so to speak? It's a company called Boeing. Boeing makes jets, but they don't run jets. They make all the 747s, etc. But people with good ideas start American Airlines, JetBlue, this thing. They create an airline, and they go to Boeing, and they tell Boeing, hey, I want to make my jet like this. I want it with 302 seats. I want it with this. I want it with this, and I want it with this. And they design, so to speak, the nuts and bolts of what that jet's going to be, and they run an airline. They don't make their own plane. Likewise, 90% of the products that you see on the market today are not made by the company that's the name on the package. They are made by what we call a co-packer or a private label. Very, 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 very important concept to know, because people think when they have an idea, how am I going to do it? My kitchen's not big enough. My garage is not big enough. My warehouse, whatever it is, how am I going to do this? There are people who make all the products. There's very few. Frito-Lay has their own factories, and a number of other. Heinz has their own factories. But most products that you see on the food shelf are not made by the company.
Even
kosher products? Definitely with those. Without it, I mean, I know myself, probably I can name, because I was in that business, so I know 5 or 6 co-packers who make, for instance, all the stuff for Trader Joe's and all the stuff for Whole Foods and all the things that you see, all the baked goods, they're all made by a number of factories, and they have various hectares of Hafke, OK. A lot of them are dairy. We came out with a nutrition bar that was par, and we had to wait till Monday because it had 24 hours, so we had a whole thing that we had to do with it. But they're made in these places. The point is, and the good news, is that you don't have to do it yourself. That if you have a really good idea, and you have something that you want to get to the market, there is amazing teams that want to have an interest for you to make it, and have an interest for you to succeed with your product. And these are the private label companies. So, that's a little bit about how the ins and outs of private labeling work. But in addition to this part of the seminar, we want to talk about private labeling, licensing, and joint ventures. Another way, a lot of people come to me, or have come to me, and they say, you know, I have this great product, and I do it this, you know, I do it in my kitchen like this, like that, and I'll tell them, listen, for instance, there was somebody who was making a product, this is a real example, I'm not going to say what the product is, but somebody came with the product, and they wanted to do it on a bigger scale. So I told them, listen, Marketplace has a kitchen. Marketplace, like any other company, see, what people have to understand is these companies are always looking to have better products. So if you have a good idea, I said, go to him, go to the Marketplace with your idea. They would love to have this product. Put it on, you know, give them your product, make a joint venture, split up the products, and you have somebody who's gonna make your product and get it on the shelves, just like that, rather than you do it yourself. It costs you less money, it costs you less hassle, and of course you have to have a good partner, but I'm just giving you a practical example of how that can work. So that's a joint venture. Licensing, and you might have heard this term before, is that you have an idea. Also, let's just say you have an idea for a new drill bit. So who would you go to? You go to Black & Decker. And you tell Black & Decker, listen, I have a patent, which we're going to get to the next part. And you go with an NDA, which is called a non-disclosure agreement. So you're protected. You know, people get fear, but don't worry. People are protected, especially with a good company. And you say to them, listen, I have a drill bit nobody has. Okay, I don't want to do this whole thing myself and come out with all the packaging and spend hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars to do it myself. I'll give you the license for it for X amount of royalty, and boom, that's a deal. That's a deal. So there's another way of getting something, another way of something done. And these are three creative ideas of really making your ideas into practicality and reality. And again, I don't know which way to go. I can't tell you that, obviously, because I don't know the product, but I want to give you those ideas in which you can think about those options for whatever ideas you have. And I personally, when I think about doing everything myself, which I did, and I drove the truck and I delivered, when I think about redoing certain things, I for sure would have preferred to have some type of joint venture with the right people. Because it could have got me a lot farther, a lot quicker, and a lot less sweat, and it gives me the ability to do what I was good at. But again, it's after the fact, but that's why I want to at least get that on the table for everyone here today, because how important it is and how key it is to the success of a product. Another thing, very important. I hope there's not a lot of perfectionists here, because it's very, very hard for a perfectionist to be in business and to make a product. Because, let's face it, it's very, very rare that it could be perfected, whatever the product is. I saw a lot of people, perfectionists, spend a lot of money building their product, building their service, but never getting it to the market. Why? Because some design wasn't exactly perfect, the label wasn't perfect, the logo wasn't perfect, and it's like to say the operation succeeded, but the patient died. Very important. It's never going to be perfect, ever. So once you know that, it frees you up to say, okay, you know what? I can go to the market. And my thought is, if you're 80% or better, you go to the market. Meaning, if you're at 80% in anything, in other words, you know, pulling springs, I didn't like maybe this or I didn't like that, but I have the product, it's 80%, you go to the market. Because you gotta get to the market, otherwise it doesn't exist. So, very, 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 very important. It's not gonna be 99 or 100%, ever. So, I just wanna re-emphasize and double emphasize that important. And that frees you up to say, okay, you know, I'm gonna make it good, you know, I'm gonna make it, do the best I can, but get it to the market. Okay, I'm gonna bring another key phrase, since we're talking about the market, and Yossi will really expound on this, but I just wanna bring this phrase in, and I think he will be on board with it, and that is, love your product or service, but don't fall in love with it. Love your product or service, but don't fall in love. Fall in love with the market. What does it mean? Simply put, and I'll use my example, I fell in love with the product that I was doing, my You Are What You Eat energy bar. And after hundreds of thousands of dollars, the market was telling me I wasn't getting the sales through. I had distribution all the, when I started my own bar, it was because I had all the distribution in the grocery stores, and I said, you know what, I'm gonna make my own product and just filter it in. But I made a product in the late 90s that was an energy bar, And at the time, the protein revolution was going crazy. But I thought taste was the key. You have something that tastes amazing, that's all people wanted. So we worked on the formula to make it the best tasting bar possible. What happened? I would sit there, I used to go in the store, that's where I lived, in the stores. So, thank God I'm at a seminar tonight doing, some of my wife would be like at this time, where is John? I'm in the stores looking at where all my products are. Because in LA, the traffic's so crazy, so you have to do it at 9, 10 o'clock at night. But I would love to be in the stores. I'd watch people go to my section, I'd look at people actually pick up my bar, look at the ingredients, and then put it back, and take the bar next to it. And I'd be like, why are they taking that bar? Take my bar! You know, once in a while they take it and you get a big thrill. But I realized, my bar had 4 grams of protein. The bar next to it had 20. So it didn't matter. I could not tell them, it didn't have a microphone. This bar tastes so good. This bar is the best bar ever. You'll never, they just saw 20 grams of protein, 4 grams of protein. That was it, that deal. So, we love it. I fell in love with the product. So rather than stopping, changing gears, which I could have, I kept going. It's when you're in love, you know, you're in love. Love the product. Don't fall in love with your product. Love it, for sure. For sure, happy to be great. You don't want to have a bad product. But fall in love with the market. The market is everything. The market dictates everything. Sorry to say, that's the reality. That's just how it is. And when you love the market, you will have that ability to make those fine tunes that can make your company or your product or your service unbelievably great. You have to listen to those customers. And again, that doesn't mean those two abusive customers that tell you to do this and do that. Believe me, when I was making a product, and you start telling your friends, it's too sweet, it's not enough sweet, it's too big, it's too small, you're gonna get 1,000 people telling you what to do. That's too much. You still have to go with it. You know, you can never make it perfect. That's back to the perfection thing again. How big are you gonna make the product? You make it this size, too big, too small, it's a single serving, it's another whole class we can do at another time. But don't fall in love with your product. Okay. So far, so good?
How are you doing the time?
How are we doing? Perfect. We're gonna do 15 minutes and then, great. Okay, because we're on number four and it's going to be a little nuts and bolts, but I think it's important. And sometimes the more snail type issues, you know, they're not so exciting. But again, we're going to get to the marketing and sales, so all the exciting part and the interaction later. But I think it's important. And that is trademarks, patents, copyrights, and business licenses. And how are you going to set up your company? You've got to set up a company. Now, there's 4 basic ways of setting up a company. We're going to start with that. That you could be a sole proprietor, you could be a corporation, a C corporation, you could be an S corporation, you could be an LLC. I'm not going to get into the details of it. I just wanted to bring this out of how a company, the genesis of a company begins. From thought, from mind to market. You're making a business now. So you have an idea. A lot of times people start with a sole proprietorship, which is the easiest way. You just go down and get a business license, and then you go down, you spend about 2 hours in line at Borough Hall around there. You get a license, they'll give you a tax ID number, and you can open a bank account and start a business. But you don't have any legal backup with a sole proprietorship. It's just under yourself. That's why people do incorporate, because a corporation is a separate entity. So that's something to discuss again with a legal advisor, an accounting advisor. Also, I believe Rabbi Yehuda Berg also is good for discussing these type of of concepts. So he's on staff here, but this is how you start. You decide how you're going to start, and again, each of them costs a certain amount of money, and depending if you have partners, etc. Number two, trademarking your idea. Very, very important. You have the idea. It's not complicated. There's a trademark. So you can, I mean, an amazing thing with the internet today. You can search trademark, and then you'll see the search and trademark office, and they'll have the names, and you could actually put in any name in a query. So you, let's say you have an idea right now for a name. You can know right away if that name is pretty much available. If it's available, then you can take it to the next step, which just takes about 13 to 18 months once you start the process. But they give you what's called a little, once you start the process, you get what's called a TM, so you can actually put a TM beside your name and your product. And then once you get the registration, that changes from a TM to an R. But if you're in the process, you're protected. And a trademark isn't so expensive. It costs maybe $750, depending on the complexity of the trademark and the legal team that you have. But it's very, very important, because a lot of people go again with ideas, they don't think about it, and then later on, boom. The worst thing you can do is come out with a product or a service, and then you're infringing somebody's trademark, and that's it. They're gonna send you a cease and desist letter, which is the last thing you wanna do. Patenting your idea, also much more complicated, but again, it needs to be done. Average of about 32 months to patent an idea, and it costs about $2,500 and up. And that's for any invention that you might have, but again, you have to protect it. I mean, if you invented something, you better protect it, because number one, that's the value you have to the marketplace, is that it's yours. So
it's cheaper than that. Start with a provisional patent that only costs $130.
No, you can. I'm just saying, eventually. Yeah, yes, you can start. Correct. You are correct. But on average, it can get quite expensive once you get a real patent. But for sure, you got to start. Copyrighting and intellectual property, or IP, which is anybody who is artistic or has music or designs or symbols. Not expensive at all, and short time, 3 to 10 months to copyright. 10 months for a book can cost maybe $275. Very, very important. I trademarked the name You Are What You Eat. That was the name of the company, but it was called a very, very weak trademark. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but I just would just from a personal experience, because they basically said you can't trademark a phrase that people use and constantly. So even though I had it and I made it a product, I made a company name with it, and I made a product with it, and I had unique products which were under that trademark, but they said, you know, what's called a weak trademark. A good trademark would be something like, I mean, what's the best trademark company name in the world? Probably Kleenex. I mean, it was only maybe a few years ago I realized that Kleenex was the name of a brand, not a tissue. I mean, it's got to be the best trademark, you know, in the world. I mean, I think we all think of Kleenex as a tissue, but it's Kleenex. I mean, everybody says, give me a Kleenex, but you could, no matter what.
Soon it's going to be Google for websites.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You have a number for a cat.
Exactly. Exactly. So these are amazing trademark. So that's some of the legal aspects. Okay. Next, number five. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Period. Didn't make that up, but you got a plan, and this is about financing your business. And you got to figure out and create a financial plan, how the business is going to be funded, okay? How and where and what risk you want to associate with funding the business. You're going to mortgage the house, you're going to mortgage the car, you're going to sell the gold. How are you going to fund this business? Are you going to be self-funded? Are you going to have partners? Are you going to borrow from friends and family? From the bank, which is pretty hard. It's pretty unlikely and hard. And the likely scenario is two things in business. And that is that you're always going to need more money, and you're always going to need more time. Whatever reason, it's just how it works. I can just tell you that that's the reality. Also, you need to have a salary, because it's very hard to be in business, start a business in the first year, second year, and to take a salary. So it's extremely difficult. So you have to rely on savings, but yet how are you going to save if you're going to invest in the business? But it's very important to face that, because not facing it can really lead to treacherous waters financially. And if you do take partners and you do borrow from family and friends, or they do invest, I'm going to just say something very, very adamantly, and that is, I beg, I plead, that if you learn one thing here tonight, that if you do borrow or you do take money, they invest in your business, you put it in writing. I don't care if it's your sister, your brother, your father, your mother, your son, whoever it is, even if it's a one paragraph, because otherwise you're in a lose-lose situation. Why? Because if the business succeeds, it won't be clear on what each person gets. So therefore, whoever gave you the money is always going to want more. And of course, if the business does not succeed and they don't get their money back, they're going to figure out a way. Why I lost that money. But if you have it in writing and you have it clear that these are the circumstances, and again, I can't tell you how important this is, because you'll keep your friends, you'll keep your family in good standing. It's the hardest thing to do. It's the hardest thing to do, because we all, $85,000, yeah, no problem. It's always no problem. But I promise you, you will save relationships. So I really, really plead that whatever you do, and it's simple, you can have a simple agreement. You don't have to have 5 pages of this or that, but just something simple. I don't care. That, listen, I need $5,000. I plan to pay it back this way. If I don't, this, you know, something in writing. Okay. We're almost through. Okay, I want to spend a minute on one other very, very urgent thing here, and that is the difference between two concepts: markup and margin. Since we're talking about finance, I can't tell you how many business people still today speak this word markup. Which, if I had a blackboard, I would exit out of the person's vocabulary. There is no such thing as markup in business. Somebody says, I have a markup. What does it mean? I'll give you an example. You buy something for 50 cents and you sell it for a dollar, you have what's called 100% markup. It is useless for any other business practice other than saying I have 100% markup. Everything is called gross profit or margin. If you buy something for 50 and you sell it for a dollar, you have 50 divided by a dollar, which is a 50%. Oh, sorry. You have a 50% gross profit. That's all that matters in your business. And I've had people, seasoned people in business, they go, oh, I marked this up 30%. I marked, you really? It's not on any accounting form. Everything is gross profit. So if you're talking about, if you think you have a 33% a markup, which means you bought something for 75 cents and you sold it for a dollar, that's 33.5 cents, basically 34% markup, it doesn't mean anything. Very, 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 very important, the difference. So everything is about what we call gross profit. So, okay, great. That's number 5, financing. Okay, Number six. It's a little bit of a slogan, but it's wear many hats, but at least one has to fit. Wear many hats, but at least one has to fit. What does it mean? It means it's very important to know what you're good at and what you're not good at. This is essential, essential, essential for the success of the business. Baruch Hashem, we live in an age that if we're not good at something, we can usually find somebody or find somebody who's good at what you're not good at. Even though you have to wear all the hats sometimes when you're starting a business, for sure, but you have to know as your business grows what you're good at, because if you start doing everything and the things that you're not good at, it means, and you have to have the humility to know, that it means that you're going to have flaws in your business. If you're not good in accounting and you have to count profitability, you might have flaws. If you're not good with interaction and you have human resources, you have to hire people, you have to have people, employees. If you're not good with that, you have to know that. Again, you can work on it. Everybody should work on every possible aspect to refine and better themselves. But it's very, very, very important to capitalize on what you're good at and delegate, this beautiful word, delegate, of what you're not. So, especially when you're growing the business, again, I can only go by experience. I waited way too long to get what we call a chief operation officer for my company. And I was doing the sales, I was doing the marketing, I was, you know, if somebody came in late, I was following that, I was doing the ordering, I was everything. And I had 21 employees at one point, and it was wrong. But you get so caught up, you know, when you're near the page, you can't read the words. So a lot of times in your own business, that's why consultants, and I'm going to finish this part with, and it'll be an ushering into to Yossi, Joe. That's why consultants make the big bucks. Why would somebody pay so much money to come in and consult your company? Why? Well, what do they know? They come in because they see things that you don't see. They see things unbiasedly. And that's why it's always important to have somebody who can see the watermark. To say, hey, listen, you know, you're doing this great, but here you need improvement. Here you're doing great. Here we can do this. I can see another market for you. I can see another opportunity here. They can see things that nobody sees. And that's why I don't care if you're the biggest company in the world. They hire consultants night and day, the top consultants. And they get paid a lot of money. And deservingly so, because they help companies see what they can't see. And on a small level, the same thing. They help you. You know, anybody else, any outside advice is going to help you see what you can't see in your company. So that's number six. Wear many hats, but at least one, you have to be good and know what you're good at.